Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome in the name of the Lord. Thank you for being the body of Christ, gathered around word and sacrament. In today's gospel, Jesus makes an urgent call to discipleship. May God bring us the ears to hear and the heart to follow. This is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost, but it is also the feast of St. Michael and All Angels. No presents, please. We lift up our prayers in support of all those seeking to bring a ceasefire to the fighting in Gaza and Lebanon. Lord, have mercy. Our hearts also go out to the many thousands of our fellow Americans seeking to recover from Hurricane Helene. Lutheran disaster response is already on the ground in the affected states. And to contribute to their work, you can go to elca.org and type in Lutheran disaster response. Just before service, I received word that Pastor Grace Olson's husband, Roy, had passed away. And so I know you want to remember her in your prayers as well. We're blessed to have Donna Lyne. Hi, Donna. Contributing her gifts to our worship today. She prepares us for our service with her rendition of Eye Has Not Seen by Arnie Howard.
I have not seen.
As you are able, please rise for the order for confession and forgiveness included in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin and come to God for healing. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings that war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing, your sins are forgiven.
Amen.
We sing hymn number 532 out of the Red Books, Gather Us In.
For the peace from above. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. We will see thee at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you
They ask you, like, how was school today? How did things go? because that's where family happens, right?
Oftentimes around the dinner table.
Do you have a dinner table in your house where you're growing up? Family happens there all the time. There was one rule in my house, well, there was a lot of rules actually, but one rule in particular, you never late for dinner. The mom put the food on the table, you were supposed to be there, because she believed that the time around the table was important. As church, we gather around the table too. We take the bread, the wine, the body, and blood of Christ, right? Right? You okay? Yeah, you okay? Okay. And here's where we have the bread and wine too for everybody in the church. Because everybody's welcome, right? Everybody's welcome. And we get all together. Oh, you can't sit up? Oh, I hope I don't step on you. That'd be a big problem. That'd be... Oh, now you get up. Okay. All right. You guys good? Can I see a little tour around here? We'll do some more touring, okay? All right. I'm seeing you back to your mom over here, and you got one Sunday school.
Should I start again?
No.
Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight that you laid the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give birth to them? That you should say to me, carry them in your bosom, as a nurse carries a suckling child, to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors. Where am I to get meat to give to all these people? For they come weeping to me and say, give us meat to eat. I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you are going to treat me, put me to death once. I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting, and have them take their place there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other Medad. And the Spirit rested on them. They were among those who registered, but had not gone out to the tent. So they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord, Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would have put his Spirit on them?" The responsive reading is Psalm 19, verse 7 through 14. The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More than we desire are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey, than honey in the comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can detect one's own offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound, and innocent of great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
The second reading is from James chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel acclamation. Better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. But if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Sisters and brothers in Christ, may the Lord keep all your days and deeds in the grace and mercy of Jesus, the Messiah. Amen. As you may recall from ninth grade English, hyperbole is an exaggeration not meant to be taken literally. For example, if I were to assert that Louisiana State University, my alma mater, has the greatest athletic program in the universe, that would be an exaggeration. If only slightly. Since we don't know about sports outside our planet, claiming universal dominance for LSU is a bit of a stretch again, if only slightly. During this election season, hyperbole is all over the place as candidates make exaggerated promises that they hope we don't take literally. I'll lower prices, I'll lower taxes, I'll end crime, I'll end our divisions, I'll end war, I'll put a chicken in every pot and a Ford in every garage. An argument can be made that Jesus is speaking hyperbolically in today's gospel. When Jesus says, if your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. Is Jesus speaking literally? Does Jesus intend for us to maim ourselves if in the weakness of our flesh we should stumble into sin? There's no evidence that Jesus' original apostles and disciples ever took these words in their literal sense. St. Paul wrote that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, himself included, but he didn't start hacking away at himself. There are stories here and there that some over-the-top monks would harm themselves to show their devotion to Christ, but thankfully that never caught on. Every time I meet a fundamentalist who insists that he or she takes every word of the Bible literally, I immediately check to see if they have all their Bible parts. What Jesus is saying very dramatically is that the kingdom of God is so great, so wonderful, so absolutely priceless, that we would gladly surrender whatever would stand between us and that kingdom. Now, by kingdom of God, I don't mean a castle in the sky. When I was a little boy, I loved the TV show, The Wonderful World of Disney. Anybody remember?
Sure.
And you remember how that show opened? It would always open with an image of the magic kingdom, around which Tinkerbell would fly and sprinkle pixie dust. That's not the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is the rule of God in our lives. And where God rules, There is forgiveness, there is grace, there is peace, there is freedom, there is beauty and joy about the kingdom. You literally cannot say too much. Hyperbole is impossible when it comes to the kingly rule that Christ brings to us. So to possess the blessings of Christ, a person would gladly surrender anything. Today's gospel is of a piece with Jesus' parable of the secret treasure. The kingdom of God, taught Jesus, is like hope, a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. In the same vein, Jesus continued, comparing the kingdom to a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Peter, James, John lived out these parables, and they left their fishing nets, their very livelihood, to follow Christ. Jesus spoke of how our mortal flesh and hands, feet, eyes can cause us to stumble. I remember the Sunday school song. Be careful of the eyes, what you see. Mm-hmm. Be careful of the hands, what you do. Be careful of the feet, where you go. Yeah. Simple words, but still very true. There's a lot to be said about minding your P's and Q's. But of all the things that keep us from seeking Christ and His rule in our lives, I think fear is the greatest stumbling block. Let me quickly add that fear is not always a bad thing. Fear is often a positive factor in keeping us alive. The fear of God, says the book of Proverbs, is the beginning of wisdom. When we devoutly respect God and all God's greatness and goodness, that fear lays the groundwork, the foundation for knowledge and insight. But fear can also be the dead weight that keeps us from the future God wills for us. And to state the obvious, we live in fearful times. Yes?
Yes.
Fear, I think, feeds the sense of grievance that pervades so much of our civic life. We fear that we are losing our place. We fear that others are encroaching upon our prerogatives. We fear that somebody somewhere is getting something that they don't deserve, but we do. Yet for us, the deepest and most problematic of all the fear in this world is the fear that God is not going to keep God's promises. The fear that we'll be left high and dry and forsaken. Letting go of these fears requires sacrifice. Sacrifice every bit as drastic as what Jesus details in today's gospel. Fear has a way of weaving itself into the fabric of our lives. Many of us grew up with fears of those people, that neighborhood, that church. My wife Carolyn remembers a lady from the church in which she grew up saying, "I would rather see my son dead than married to a Catholic." Crazy. Fearful. Fearful. And fear makes us say and do crazy things.
is not for the faint of heart. I don't typically close a sermon with a quote, but I'll make an exception today, quoting from Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the subject of our adult forum study. Grace is costly because it calls us to follow. And it is grace because it calls us to follow Christ. It is costly because it costs the person their life. And it is grace because it gives that person the only true life. It is costly because it condemns sin, and grace because it justifies the sin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may rise for the hymn of the day. It's number 18. Do I have that right? You change it.
804.
Okay. There we go. You got it right? 804. You may rise.
Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again.
He ascended into heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father,
and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. We pray for the people of God in all places. Shape our witness to the good news of Jesus, that we joyfully share your transforming love with all whom we encounter. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the healing of the earth. Renew oceans and seas, marches and its streams. Uphold the work of conservationists, oceanographers, and all who care for fragile ecosystems and habitats. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for peace and cooperation among local and global communities. Bless the efforts of community organizers, international aid workers, and all those who work for justice and peace around the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all who are in any need, to all who grieve, bringing consolation, to all who are weary or lonely, bring solace. By your grace, make your presence known among all who call to you for healing, including Chuck, Clark, Don, Joe, Tara, Christine, Bill, Michael, Shelley, Jan, Karen, Lois Ann, John, Donald, Rita, Lenny, Bucky, Jim, Shirley, Jeff, Carla, Debbie, Charlie, Peggy, Tony, our homebound family and friends, the St. John's Call Committee, our future pastor, and the family of friends of David Bollinger, Bernice Fisher, Marion Truck, Janet Hefner, Earl Kaiser, and Roy Olson, and all those whom we name silently or aloud in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for caregivers, doctors and nurses, aides and counselors, and those who care for loved. Sustain them in their work and help us to build a healthy care system that supports all. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You know our fears, our confusions, our frustrations, the wars and disasters going on around the world. Help us to know your peace and give us the strength that we need in conquering. Lord, hear our prayer.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for the saints who now rest in your eternal presence. In thanksgiving for their lives of faithful service and witness, we commend to your loving care. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust those and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of our beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
All right, you get out the peace sign. All right, peace sign. All right, yeah. Wave. All right, let's say, wait. Let's do a big peace sign wave. Okay, everybody, wave. Look, they're really getting into it back over there. They got it going on. Thank you so much. God bless you all. Okay. You may be seated as we receive our offering and as we hear our special music. Thank you.
Please rise as we sing the offering for you.
Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father,
with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated for a few announcements. Thank you for lifting up your hearts in this morning's service, and a special thanks to Donna Lyme for contributing her considerable following. That was not an afterthought. I appreciate it so much. Thank you. After worship, please join us in the gallery for food and fellowship. There's a new art exhibit in the gallery, and I know you'll want to see that. The choir is rehearsing tomorrow at 1 p.m. here in the sanctuary. All are welcome. Next weekend is Garlic Fest. We won't be checking anybody's breath. But we're looking for volunteer parking attendants. It's a sign-up sheet in the narthex, I think. If not, you can check with Bob Black. We charge people to park in our parking lot for these kind of special festivals. And, you know, it raises a considerable amount of money that we can then put to work in our larger community. So thank you for your volunteer efforts on that. Also in the narthex are copies of the letter that Presiding Bishop Easton wrote in response to the recent comments on Haitian immigrants in Springfield, Ohio. Perhaps you've heard them. Yes. It's a very well-written letter. Take a look at it. Are there any further announcements? Did I hit all the bases?
Bill's going to have his surgery on Wednesday.
What was that?
Bill was having surgery on Wednesday.
Bill,
he's
going to get that ankle taken care of.
It's going to be fused on Wednesday, yes.
No, you'll be kicking field goals before we know it.
Thank you.
I know it's caused him a lot of trouble in turn. After worship this morning, I'll be leaving with my family for a 50th wedding anniversary. Hard to believe, Carolyn and I were just six when we got married. So if I knock anybody down on the way out, please rise for the blessing. God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you and keep you and give you peace.
Amen.
Return to our Sunday song. I think I got the wrong number. 774. Is that right?
Yes. 774. Okay.